side am I on? What side am I supposed to be on? I never know.
Shit, it's Don Barry. He looks good. He wasn't here, but then he wasn't here, and then he was here. And there's Steve Lines. What's up tonight? How's everybody doing? Hope everybody is well. I got the tambourine shirt on. Later we'll talk about what the tambourine shirt actually really means. And we're going to discuss a lot of stuff tonight. I threw out a couple lifelines out there to a couple YouTubers out in the YouTube world that are local. And we'll continue to try to do that, and we'll try to meet these people, see what they do, see where they go, see what motivated them, where they come from, where they going. Tonight, we're going to use Don can do it too, I guess. Tonight, we're going to have Dean on, and Dean is going to go through, you know, have you ever wondered how in the hell he got started? You know, how do you get involved in this? How do you get sucked down this line? If you ever decided you wanted to do this for work, do you want to do social media stuff? If you ever decided that you wanted to do that, this is going to be the time to do it. I got a hold of, I sent a flyer out to Jerry Arizona. He did not respond. I sent a flyer out to Cactus Atlas. If you're not familiar with that gentleman, he does a lot of the same things that we do, goes to a lot of the same places. You know, Jerry does his deal. You know, I've sent flyers out to other people, say flyers, emails, things like that. For some reason, it's a weird thing to get people on live for some reason. I, you know, it's kind of weird. And maybe it's just me, but you know, it's kind of like, if you're going to do this, you kind of got to do this. You know, if you're going to be involved in that and you're going to get in front of the camera, which a lot of people are totally uncomfortable with. I do get that. My story is that the only reason I got into doing videos is because I worked at a dealership and they needed somebody to do sales videos, and they needed to do videos of product, and nobody wanted to do it. And I thought, well, I'll jump in the middle of it. And that's kind of where I got started on the video side of it to some degree. Not all of it. We'll go into a little bit about what I did and how I did it, where we went and where we're going, what we're doing, how difficult it is to try to get this done. But, you know, there's no one out there that couldn't do that. Don says that just talking live on the phone is uncomfortable. You know, a lot of people feel that way. A lot of people do. I won't go into detail on who said what, but I more than one time have had people that go, man, I just can't go. I can't do it. You know, I can't do it. There's something about, you know, and I try to tell people, hey, it's just like being on the phone. I mean, it really isn't that big a deal. But a lot of people don't want to do it, and I definitely get it. But if you have a business, it would probably be in your best interest to be involved somehow, to do some type of social media stuff. I mean, the thing about it, it is free. And if you can promote your business or become an expert on some subject or however you would like to do it. But we're going to talk to Dean about, you know, we're going to kind of get into the dirty as well as the clean, I guess you could say, because there's a lot of things involved in this that, that people don't really realize how much effort goes into doing some of this stuff. And I ended up falling into the live side of it. I really like the live side of it. I actually prefer the live side of it more than I do just going out and shooting videos. But if you know, and that's another one of the goals, is to there is a system that you can buy that will allow you to go live anywhere. And I would think that would be a kind of a neat twist, a neat concept to go live, like wherever you're at. If you're fans of TikTok, for example, there is a lot of, you know, their whole story behind what they're doing right now is live. That's the kind of the direction it appears that TikTok is going. You know, if you're watching this on YouTube, they have a system in place. I don't think it's as good as TikTok's, as far as TikTok will open the door up regardless, and they'll allow you to get, you know, 1,000. You could have 5,000 people on a TikTok, where in YouTube, they don't open it up really and send it out. So you really don't get that, you know, unless you have a large channel. And then we'll talk about that too. How do you get a large channel? What do you do today? What are the mistakes that I've made? What would I change if I were going to do it again? What cameras are I'm shooting? What kind of equipment do I use to do this? What kind of equipment do I use? What am I shooting now? I mean, I had a cinema camera at one time. I was shooting a Canon. I had all the lenses and all the stuff. And so when we went out, we would do that. And you talk about hauling a bunch of crap. Porter had a thing on Facebook. I think it was Porter who had a thing on Facebook about he's getting ready to go out and all this stuff that you have to have. You know, he had all his stuff, all his cameras, all his lenses, and you're hauling that stuff around and you're out in the dirt. And I know there's guys out there that do it. And then there's a point where, you know, with me, and again, this is just me, you fall down enough times, you break enough stuff. And then all of a sudden you're like, you know what? I'm not going to haul that around anymore. And then you change cameras and you go out. So what do you need today? You know how many YouTubers shoot on their phones? You would be stunned. You would be stunned to know how many of your favorite YouTubers are shooting on a phone. You would be stunned. And if somebody said to me, well, I would invest in a good phone right now. If I was starting off fresh today and somebody said, what do you want? I would either shoot, I've shooting GoPros now. I'd either shoot a GoPro or a DJI, and I would have a Rode mic, and I'll show you those guys. I'll show you that stuff if I'm going to shoot it again. One of the other things that you can use YouTube for as well is it's a great place to put stuff. Even if you're not a big YouTuber and you're not, you know, doing a ton of stuff, it's a great platform for you to place stuff in so you can watch it later. And so you can download this stuff into YouTube and have basically a library. I use it as much for a library as I do anything else right now. Which is interesting because that is, when I started this, I had a cinema camera. I shot all the lenses. I've had all that stuff. I went through all the mics, all the effort that, you know, it comes down to, and now you can shoot back on your phone. And now shorts are a big deal. And so you've got to stay up on what's going on with that type of stuff. Your black light, having a bunch of equipment to bring out totally affects what you do, where you go, and when you do it. You know, a lot of people haul this stuff out, man. They do. John used to have this massive camera that he used to take out, which was awesome. Don't get me wrong, but man, you know, there's a program that you, that GoPro, for example, has, that if you, for any reason, ruin your camera or break your camera, it's not that much. I'm thinking it's like $70 a year or something. They'll also allow you to store as much stuff as you want on their platform as far as media. But if you fall, you drop it, they just send you another one, man. I mean, they send you another camera. And if you do this type of stuff where you're doing outdoor stuff, you're going to drop, you're going to lose, you're going to bang around, you're going to all that kind of stuff. And right now I'm shooting, I've got one extra GoPro in the drawer that has not been opened that I got a redo on because I had a problem with it. And so they've sent me a new one. But I'm shooting basically two cameras right now. And I've got the same setup for both of them. And I'll show you that and we'll go through it. But you know, you don't have to be a YouTuber to be able to say, hey, to be able to have a library of your stuff that you've done, you know, the places, locations you went, it's very simple to download. It's a pretty easy situation. And, you know, if you don't have to be the next big YouTuber or try to be the next big YouTuber, it's really cool to be able to have someplace to go and people other than yourself. And you can put it private. You don't have to put the stuff out. And so it's a pretty easy deal. There's Tom and there's Brian. What's up? And there's hi, Tom and Steve. Yeah, perfect. So you're going to talk about that a little bit tonight, and we're going to talk about how we get it. You know, how in the hell do you get into this? What and where are you going with it? And you know, the biggest thing I would tell anybody is that, you know, with my mental illness, I try to entertain myself. So half of the stuff that I'm doing is trying to entertain myself, try to come up with things that are cool and that are good. You know, my big deal right now is to get this another e-bike up and built. And then I'm going to go to TC 125 Hondas and a 150. They make a new 150 model for $29.99, which appears to be the steal of all steals ever. And so hopefully it'll be doing a lot of trail stuff coming up, going to the same locations, but using different forms, and to try to expand the audience. Because when you're doing small things like ruins and petroglyphs, you know, the first thing I'd ask you, if you were going to start a channel, I'd ask you, well, what are you going to do it on? And it's important, because if there's nobody doing it, then you're probably not going to be the first guy out there that has this massive following. YouTube and Google go after channels that already exist. So they try to pair you up with somebody like, hey, he's like this, or he does stuff like this. And if you don't have a bunch of people on there already doing that, then Google has a hard time saying, hey, we're going to put you in this category. And so when you look at, you know, if I would have looked at the biggest channel for petroglyphs, for example, and, you know, you got a guy that's got 20,000, that's not enough subscribers to try to make anything. It's cool to be able to tell people that you have, 20,000 people, but man, it's not going to financially do anything for you. You got to be in 100 to just even start making any sense of anything that you're doing. But, you know, I'm not going to put anybody off that's still looking to try to do this or go down that road or try to find, you know, different ways to do it. You know, Newsbreak was very lucrative for me and Dean both. And we thought maybe this is going to be the outlet that's going to allow us to maybe possibly do this for a living. And as soon as it started, it does what every one of these platforms does. They come in, they build their platform, they pay you. And then as soon as they build their platform, then they cut it. And so all of a sudden now what you were making a few hundred bucks on, now you're making $3 and they're paying you 27 cents a video. And so the first thing I would tell anybody, whatever your content is, love what you're doing and do it. Would you do this if you could do it for free? Because most likely, most of the time, you are going to be doing it for free. You know, one of the advantages I get is, you know, I have people that definitely have helped me and support me through this, and it's much appreciated. I wouldn't be this far if it wasn't for them. But if you're looking for what you make on YouTube itself, for example, you know, $35 on a good month. I mean, that's a good month. So, you know, there's other people that might be making a couple hundred bucks out of it, but you know, you guys know as well as I do, go to the gas station and all of a sudden that's taken care of. In case he has to leave early, there's Mr. Lines. And I appreciate that, sir. Thank you very much. If you stay, that'd be awesome too. But if you leave, then I get it. I appreciate that, sir. Thank you very much. And I don't know where the stuff is that we haven't done one for a while. There was one I really liked and I don't know what happened to it. But we'll do the Voodoo Daddy because that worked.
Come closer. Let me tell you a secret.
Steve Lines is my voodoo daddy! Hey, is this like this? Like this?
What's a backpack? Steve Lines, what's a backpack? Don Barry, he want a backpack. Joe B, he want a backpack. Tecumseh Little Bear, he was a backpack. Don Barry, he was a backpack. Tom Rising, he want a backpack. Keith Luggins, he want a backpack. Rutgers Crystals, Tim Hoffman, he want a backpack. John D, I want a backpack. Maria D, they want a backpack. Well, everybody, they want a backpack. Jeffrey Dahmer, they want a backpack. Black Flag, they want a backpack. A Black Flag, they want a backpack. Well, a Black Flag, they want a backpack. Well, mother, we want a backpack.
1, 2, 3, hey, where can you take that backpack?
Well, I take that backpack to the mall. Who knows when I might get a booty call? Backpack. You get a booty call? Erixie's going to the neighbor's house. I hear she's hotter than a mouse. Backpack. Can I get it for $1? Backpack. Will it make me holler? Backpack. Really big backpack. Does this backpack make my ass look humongous?
Why, no. It looks tight. That's what I thought.
Well, what do you have in that big backpack? I got all of Route 66 all the way to Albuquerque. Have you ever went there and eat their deer jerky? In that backpack! Can I get $1? Backpack! Will it make me holler? Backpack!
Well, what's in that backpack? Well, everything, even Uranus?
Especially my anus. No, Uranus is dangerous.
Why you
do you have back envy? When you look at me, you don't look real friendly. I've got everything that a person could need. I've got a bale of marijuana weed in my backpack. Can I get $1 backpack? Will it make me holler backpack? It's full of weed backpack. Thank God no seeds in my backpack. Can I get $1 backpack? Will it make me holler backpack? What about my backpack, backpack? Everybody needs a backpack, Jack.
Bow, right on time. How in the hell did I know that? You have to also be somewhat psychic if you're going to do this as well. You need to be thinking ahead because you never know what's going to happen. And when it does, you got to be ready. And that was pretty epic right there, you have to admit. So, you know, there is one place I was thinking about today that I was like, you know what? So if I was going to go somewhere in town on the weekend and I wanted to go see some kind of what I thought had some history and some cool stuff, and I would go to a place, and I'm going to show you that. Dean's popping in here, but I'm going to show you this first, and then we'll pop back in. But I do want to show you on Google Earth and see if you guys, most people have seen this place. Most people know about it, but it's got some intriguing, cool stuff. Let me pull this up real quick. I'm going to share the screen, and then we're going to get into Google Earth. I love Google Earth. Okay, right here. How many people know about Castle Hot Springs? Okay, there is Castle Hot Springs, and there is Lake Pleasant. So if you are going up this road right here by Lake in Lake Pleasant, and then you follow that road up here. Now, if you're over here, you're going to see mules. If you're over here, you're going to see horses on occasion that will want to stop you in this grave, this area right here. And here's a gentleman that has every vehicle he ever owned. Now, not everybody can say that. You got to think that's pretty cool, because not everybody can say, you know, oh, I have every vehicle I have ever owned right there. And he has. But Castle Hot Springs is a cool place to take a drive. Now, staying there now is incredibly expensive. Some ridiculous amounts of money that, you know, I don't know where, you know, none of this stuff was here. These houses that are now being rented, I think, for a G to three G's a night, which is insane. But Castle Hot Springs was a place where the ancients used to go first. And then as the more modern natives came in, the Apaches and those different groups that expanded out, they used Castle Hot Springs because it is a Castle Hot Springs. And then the history goes that what happened was a bunch of railroad men came in and built what they wanted to call like a party house. And so they built this party house because of the hot springs and then the pools and all that. That's the same size as the actual original pool, I believe. And these houses here, this is the clubhouses and all this. For years, it was a dude ranch. And it's incredible to go up this road, though, and you're in the middle of this desert and you're coming through here and all of a sudden you see this desert oasis, which is incredible. And it had the first phone in Arizona. It was the phone number was number one. So the first phone was there. Now, the reason for the first phone there was Joe Kennedy, who you might know is a father of a president. When JFK got crushed in the PT boat, he was sent here to recover with the waters and the sun. So he was brought here at this location, and his dad wanted to be able to get a hold of him. So they ran a wire, a phone line, so he could get in touch with his dad. And if you look through here, there used to be a gorgeous right in here somewhere. I don't know if it's still right. Yeah, there we are. Boom. That's the old stables right there. So this became a dude ranch. And every one of the elites from the East Coast would come in here. And some of them would actually have their own like cabanas, their little cabins in here. And then it sat vacant for a long, long time. A lot of stories about JFK and the workers there, whether they're true or not true, but there it is right there. And then if you were going to, you know, if you were taking a right here, you'd be staged to go up the big hill to Crown King. So that's what's right there. So if you get a chance to go out there, it's a pretty cool deal. I like the history. You know, they wouldn't let you in there for years. I mean, I was there for years trying to get back in and could not get back in. But that is a pretty cool deal. Don still has his first car, a 55 Studebaker Speedster. That's a pretty cool car. Supercharger from a 58 Hawk. That's pretty incredible. So he has his first car. That guy had every car he ever owned. Now, what I'm going to do is we're going to pop Dean on here. He's waiting. He has a new backdrop. He's moved. He's been moving. He's got a whole new fresh setup. His mic is working strong. And we're going to bring him in here. We're going to talk about how Dean got into this whole YouTube, TikTok. We're going to look at some of his videos. We're going to ask him all the hard questions. We're going to stress him out as much as we possibly can. So let's bring him in. And here is Dean. What's up, you know? Look at that background. Oh my gosh.
Look, bookshelves and all, man. Took me about 3 hours to do that setup.
Well, it looks like I, you know, which college professor am I talking to right now? I don't even know. Yeah. Look at that.
Yeah.
Look at my mighty fine leather bound books. That looks good, man. You did an awesome job. And you got it set up right and everything's good. He has learned from what Don Barry says. He is learned. How are you doing, man?
I'm doing good. How are you?
Well, good. You got a move going. You made the big move this week.
This is, I think me and my wife said this is move 19 in 27 years of marriage. This is move 19.
That's a lot of, you know, that's a lot of moves, Dean. Is that why maybe you're a videographer?
No, that's not why. I wish I would have, you know, it would be great to be able to have some videos of all the moves and put them all together. I think the first move, flip phone was the first couple of moves. And then, we were going through stuff in the box and we found the very first Apple phones, the real small things. And my wife is like, this is like gold. And I'm like, what are you talking about? People want to give you $250 for these phones because they're like, you know, it's something from the 80s or something like that. But the very first iPhones. So at least I struck a gold there. I hope someone does give me $250 for a phone.
Well, I hope they do too. And I want to jump right into this. Because, you know, we talk about, you know that I've tried to get a hold of a couple of people to try to get them on and we weren't successful yet. I'm not saying maybe they didn't see it. A lot of people don't use Messenger on Facebook. I'm horrible with that. So I'm just going to say that maybe they didn't get it. And if they did, you know, great. If they didn't, great. So how, take me back to where Dean said, I want to put something on a video and put it on YouTube. Where did that start in your history?
February 2017. Well, you know what happened in February 2017? What product hit the market and everyone wanted one. It was the coolest thing in the world. It was futuristic. And do you remember what that product might have been?
I'm going to guess a drone.
Yeah. Yeah. That's when I know when the drones hit the market, because I couldn't get enough of, of watching these drone videos, these new drones coming out, especially all the DJI ones that they had out. And I was watching them, and one particular individual who has definitely probably reached out and touched millions in the United States and around the world to think that they can actually start a YouTube channel. And that is Mr. Casey Neistat. And I didn't know who this guy was. And prior to February 2017, I didn't just sit around and watch YouTube videos. If I went into YouTube, it was to watch news, sports, or how to. Every time my garbage disposal conked out, I went on to YouTube, and every time I fixed it, it was absolutely amazing. Anything that ever happened. So I never really went in there to watch anybody's content, you know, where they went, where they traveled. Really, I could care less at the time. And Casey Neistat sucked me into it because at that time he was still doing his daily vlogs. And man, it was outstanding. And so I watched about 15 drone videos of his because people were just sending him, like, you know, they send him all these cameras that we pay all this money for. He's got like, I don't know, about 400 or 500 nice cameras on his back wall, all smashed up and everything that people send him for reviews. And I was like, this guy is great. So after watching all the drone videos and then buying a drone that year, I was like, you know, this would be pretty fun because I love to travel. I love to check things out. We moved here in March of 2012. So we had been here for about 5 years and I've been to a lot of other places. And when I worked at the ballpark for a long time, and when I would tell these people about these spots, most of them who have lived here over 20, 25 years, they weren't born here, but they've lived here a majority of their lives. They'd be like, what are you talking about? And I'm like, you know, I went down here and this place was great. And I went down the street. It's only like 15 miles from the ballpark. And so I started telling and sharing these, and people actually would call me up on the weekend to see where their family and them would like to go. And I'm like, well, you can go out here or you can go here. And then again, the Casey Neistat bugs. I was like, look, if he can do it, I can do it. And I don't know how many people have ever said that. But I went out and I bought... I was looking for it before the show tonight, a Joby stick.
Yeah.
And then I went out and I got it right here. I went out and I bought this camera, this at the time. And so this is March or April of 2017. The new T6i came out. The 7 was coming, but this was the one that was out. And I was like, well, this is what they're using. They did a review on it. So I'm like, let me get it. It's only $750. And by the time By the time I got out of the place where I went and got it, I got the Joby, I got the SD card, I got the camera. I'm trying to think of what else I got. I got out of there for just under $1,200. Now, I haven't put a film, I haven't gone out and tried to vlog anything, but I had to have, you know, what I saw everybody else using, because hey, that must be what it is, right? The equipment must be what you need to be successful on social media.
So, real quick, a couple questions. Lines wants to know, did you go to Florence? Did you move to Florence? And what happened to your shaved head? Those are the two questions that Line wants to know.
Well, the nice thing is we're going like 7.5 months cancer free. So that all the awesome. Hair is back. Yes. I get my first scan next month. So that'll tell the true story. And then, no, I did not move to Florence. I stayed in the great Gilbert area. So someday, maybe if I hit it big, I'll buy me a house in Florence as my second home.
You know, we would hope. So, but you went to locations before though. You traveled to you drug your family as well as I drug my family locations. So the history part of it was not something new. That was something that I have done. And I believe you did the same thing.
Yeah. My poor daughter, we were in North Carolina for roughly about 7 years when I was in the military. And every weekend I hit every single Civil War battlefield, that North Carolina or Virginia had. And we drove on the weekends anywhere from 2 to 8 hours. And if you think about Civil War battlefields, all you're doing is stepping out on some grass. I loved Yorktown, Gettysburg. We went to all the revolutionary sites in Virginia. No, history was my favorite thing. So my daughter at the time, she was probably about six or seven years old. I have a lot of pictures. But we had nothing to take a video. I mean, you could take the big JVC video recorder with you, which right. was never even, I didn't even think about doing such a thing. So all over the house, we got pictures of those days, but no video.
So you get this rig, you spend the $1,200. What's your first video?
It's kind of embarrassing. But what I thought was, look, I went online and I saw some Grand Canyon videos and I'm like, you know, I can do better than that. Look, I got the rig. I got the setup. I had this little, from England that I worked with. I think he brought me some views to the younger crowd because he was like 26 or 27 years old at the time. He had the old British accent. And he hadn't gone to the Grand Canyon. So I'm just like, let's get into the car and let's head out to the Grand Canyon. We had a great time. We did some great things. And I uploaded it thinking, okay, there is my first video with at least 25,000 views. And I think, I don't know if we could go and look at it. I think as of today, that thing, I don't even know if it hit 300 views.
Is it on your channel now on YouTube?
You know what? I did take some of those down, and I think that might have been one of the ones I took down because I want to say at that point it hit 6 years, and I don't think it hit 300 views. It was the first video, and that video was a great one because it was like 19 minutes long on a 2 hour edit to get it to 19 minutes because I had so much great stuff I thought in there that I needed to stick in there. So that sucker went for 19 minutes. And blew it out at 300 views. But when I first put it out, I think if I add up all family, all friends that I send it to, I think I got like 20 or 21 views the first month on that video. YouTube didn't, just like today, YouTube still doesn't send it out.
Well, you know, I was thinking about YouTube when I first started the direction I headed. It looked like it was going to be a scenario where it might just be something and then boom, all of a sudden they drop monetization, you know, and you know, you get these handful of guys that make all the money. Right. And I think all of us down the road expect that, hey, you know, so, I mean, if you were going to tell somebody today, what would be the first piece of advice you give anybody that wanted to start a YouTube channel today? What would be your first one?
Really quick. Cause I went down I took it off. While we were in the Grand Canyon, somebody was flying a drone in the Grand Canyon. And if you ever been on the trail that goes down, I think it's the Angel, Bright Angel Trail, I think it's called. It was stopping people. So it was hot out. It was August. And there was like 50 people on one side of this thing and about 100 people waiting to go on the other side. This guy was flying. And back then, they even had, you know, it's federal law. You can't fly drones in this place. And my first video on there is not the place to fly a drone at the Grand Canyon 5 years ago. It's got 11,000 hits on it. Now, the comments that came off that was a baptism of fire. Because people thought I was the most wicked individual in the world to be videoing all these people stranded on the side of this trail. Because if you've been on Bright Angel Trail, only two people, maybe side by side, is how wide it is at a certain point down there. And people were just sitting there and just, you know, they needed water, they need to get up. And I'm like, why are we waiting here? And I videoed the guy, and that video is 50 seconds long. And I think in the first month, I got like 300 comments, and all of them was, you know, I should not be alive still for videoing such a disturbing thing there. And I need to mind my own business. So that was the baptism of fire for the comments on the YouTube was my very first video.
You know, comments are a whole nother world of, I know as we go through this, there'll be a lot of stuff that'll just hit me that I really didn't think about. But boy, you better have some thick skin if you're going to be on YouTube. You better be able to take a beating. Agreed?
Oh, it's you think you're prepared. I'm an old man. All right. You think you'll be prepared. You've been through life. You're not some, kid that, you know, still has pimples on their face and trying to, you know, impress people on a video. But some of the stuff that you get, especially when you put in the time and the effort, it's not how to better yourself maybe on YouTube or the video. The video can be fantastic, and you'll get the first 25 videos, 25 things will be, don't you, first of all, the music sucked, Arizona Timeless Tours. Your music sucks. It's too loud. I can barely hear you. And, you know, like, okay, but what about the content? And then they'll go on, how old are you, wearing your hat backwards and those glasses suck? That's about the first, you know, a few comments I'd always get on every video. Music sucked. My hat is ignorant. What am I, 20, wearing my hat backwards and the sunglasses are just stupid.
Well, it really does. You know, I learned that from the video I did with my dad about Bigfoot. And man, I still keep that up because I laugh at it now. I you know, but boy, you don't laugh at it at first. No. You know, you get where you can take a beating and you can kind of laugh at it. Now I challenge everybody. Now it's not even now it's like, okay, come on. The first thing I do when you challenge me is I go to your site to see how many videos you've got. How many videos have you made? Zero. Well, if you haven't made any videos, then don't re-rip in mine. And so that's a whole nother world of YouTube that nobody even, you know, looks at that, man, it will make you, it will give you some very thick skin if you didn't have thick skin before.
Yeah.
Small town tours, which we'll get on sometime here soon. We're not legally permitted to film in national parks anymore without a film permit. Yeah, I didn't see that. And, which is, I mean, again, let's get just ridiculous. And that's ridiculous. And
well, don't try to go to Scottsdale Fashion Mall either to try to film.
Because so what's the Scottsdale Fashion Mall story?
you put this on a Joby, and all of a sudden you become, Fox News, CBS, NBC. You're something unbelievable. My wife went out there. This is when it first started, first couple of months. And I'm like, well, hey, everywhere I go, I'm going to take the camera. And, you know, I'm from the Northeast. We don't have these outside malls. So I'm going to film a little bit of the Scottsdale Fashion Mall. Opens at 10. We were there like at 10:15. So 10:15 Wednesday morning, just dead. And I'm rolling through there, and they're down the sidewalk, and I'm holding this Joby thing, and I'm walking down, and I kind of turn it and talk about where I'm at and Scottsdale and stuff like that. And as I'm walking, just like out of some kind of, you know, action movie. And I'm not making fun of people because I've worked in this kind of security in my life too, but the rent-a-cop, the mall rent-a-cops who, you know, have everything really sharp, and they think maybe they're, you know, FBI or something. They were on, no joke, this souped up golf cart, and they came around the corner, and two of the wheels just barely came off the road and then went down, and they flew. And as the cart was still a little bit in motion, this lady jumps off the cart and she comes over to me and she's like, look, you can't be filming. And I was like, I was like, what? She's like, yeah, this is private property. This is Scottsdale, Arizona. And what are you filming? Who are you with? And do you have any paperwork to say that you are permitted to film here? And I'm like, look, I'm just here with my wife. She's over in the store. I thought I would walk through here. I'm not filming nobody because nobody's here. I'm like, and she's like, no, you have to turn the cam off. We've seen you up on the cameras that they have around everywhere. And we have been dispatched to come out and tell you to stop recording ASAP. And I just looked at her and I said, is this a joke? And she's like, no. I said, so what if I took my camera out like this and started just walking like this? I said, you wouldn't say anything. I said, this is just a DSLR camera and this is just for myself. And so they left, and I think they felt a little bad, and they came back around and they're like, look, if you go over to that building right there, you can get a permit to film here. I'm like, I don't need no permit to film here. I said, I'm not looking for no trouble from the mall security. So I left out of there. But that was my second thing I tried to film, was there in Scottsdale. And from then on, I have had a lot of stories about being confronted at all different parks, public, private, everywhere. People would come up to me and ask me, do I have paperwork or anything like that? Because they thought I was with a professional filming crew.
Well, you know how it's hard enough to just shoot yourself when you're starting anyway. You know, hard enough just to get in front of the camera and do that kind of stuff. It was for me, maybe not everybody, but it's so difficult. And then when you get accosted by security, it you know, and if anything, you're helping them, in my opinion. I've always thought that is that, you know, I mean, my gosh, what you're shooting is not going to hurt them. It's going to actually help them. I mean, the more publicity out there, I believe that,
I should have learned. I should have learned at that point right then that this thing here, because it's gotten me out there at Fort Verde. I was out there shooting at Fort Verde. This is 2 to 3 years into doing this stuff. And as I was coming back to where the ranger was and everybody, a ranger, she came up to me and she's like, you know, in order to do what you're doing, you need to have permits and stuff. So can I see what's on your film? Can I see what you were doing? Do you have a permit? And I looked at her, I said, ma'am, I said, this happens all the time. I don't understand. I said, I have a YouTube channel that you can look at anytime. It's for myself. I don't make any money on it. Still today, I don't make any money on it. If I ever met her, I'd tell her, you know, 4 years later, I'm still not making any money. And we had a cordial conversation. And after that, and she realized, she told me that I looked professional. She told me I looked more professional than the people that come out there with the permits. And I said, well, I appreciate that. And after that, she gave me a site. She gave me a cliff dwelling that was on the other side of those mountains that you see straight ahead. So I went up there and checked that out. But I realized most of the time, if I don't, you know, they come at me with an attitude. If you don't come at them with an attitude back, it usually pans out right. But it's almost everywhere I went my first couple of years, somebody came up. If it wasn't security, then it was park security, or it was a ranger, or it was hotel security, or somebody. Because again, this thing right here scares a lot of people.
Well, it is amazing. If you have like a GoPro or a phone, nobody seems to care. They don't care. I mean, so that'd be my first thing I'd tell anybody, man, have a great camera on your phone, you know, anymore in this day and age. And again, there's so many people that are using their phones for shooting. And then again, you stay out of the loop with that. You know, even a GoPro is pretty non-threatening as well. even though, you know, some people might look at it differently, a lot of them let you go through because it just doesn't look like this massive. For some reason, you got a cannon and they think you're professional or, you know, whatever. It is ridiculous. And, you know, I mean, anybody who's been doing this has had like just massive issues and problems with groups of people. You know, let's just talk about it. Let's just put the elephant in the room. You know, you go shoot these Indian ruins and then you get this war of people that is, you know, don't tell them, don't, you shouldn't show that, you should, it's secret. And I'm going to throw this in because this is my throwback, is that, oh, so only the elite people get to go see these. I see. So if you're not the in crowd, because automatically, you know, they booked us together with party groups of Facebook and all, on and on and on. I mean, just the most ridiculous, in my opinion, the most ridiculous, and almost got to a point where it was going to get really ugly. It was going to get ugly. And I think they got to, we both came to our senses because it got to a point where, you know, but it's like, I was the one that took the brunt of all of that I won't say all of it. You've had your swings, but I took a lot of brunt force in going out and shooting that stuff, which I believe was important because, you know, you don't know what kind of shape that thing's in unless somebody shooting it. You can see, hey, I shot it this day, this year, you know, it was fine. Now it's not. And finally, people, I think, pulled their heads out of their butts and realized that, you know, if it's done right, it actually helps. It actually helps instead of hinders. But man, what a war that was. What a war to make nothing. You know, I'm sure you haven't had those experiences, but
yeah, I wish I had a time machine. I go back and tell myself, don't do this. Don't do it, Dean. It's 100%. You know, we'll get to that, I'm sure. We have a gentleman that was just down here, the small town tourist, good stuff. I subscribe. I watch his stuff. I look forward to in this series, and I hope people turn this video on and watch and say, look, it's just a conversation back and forth. And again, if you can't do something live, you're in the wrong business. If you want to, you know, increase your viewership and have more opportunities, you got to do stuff like this. And if you can't, then you're not going to go anywhere. And I'm going to tell you this right now. We've had this discussion numerous times. I started off this thing just out there having a good time. And, but I wanted views. I wanted exposure. I wanted an opportunity to make money or to endorse products. And, as time goes on and you get better and better at it, your expectations go up. And, I look at some of these people and I know they have high expectations. I know by the miles they're putting on their vehicles, the places that they're going, the stuff that they're shooting, the camera equipment that they're using, they have high expectations of something happening here. And they really don't want to hear my true advice for them because it's not good.
Well, you know, all I ever wanted, I had that. I'm shooting these videos of the Lost Dutchman and man, I really got a pretty good deal. If I had stuck with the Lost Dutchman, it still would have been a dead end road eventually somewhere. But I had a pretty big deal going with the Lost Dutchman at one time because nobody was really doing it. And then that show comes up and then the opportunity comes up. It looks like an opportunity to get on TV, right? Because at that point, when I was in that, that was so much bigger than YouTube. At that point, you still wanted to be on TV. Now I can't say you do, but, you know, my goal only was not to do YouTube. It was to have a page that people could go to, but I wanted to be on one of these TV shows. And, you know, I have chased that for all these years and, you know, five swings but I never wanted to be big on YouTube. I just wanted a place where if I was could get a role on one of these shows that people would have a place to go see. And then, you know, maybe I could build a page off of that. But that was my goal always, just to, man, if I could get on Discovery Channel, if I could get on a History Channel, Man, that would be the greatest thing ever. So, you know, my goal was never at any of these times to be a big, big YouTuber. I wanted to be on TV. That's my story, right, wrong, or indifferent. And it just, it didn't work down that road either, but by golly, I gave it the old college try. I'll say that much.
Yeah. 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 You know, I've gotten a few things out of this. I've got some money out of this. And, at the end of the summer here, some of my footage will be in a documentary on the History Channel. It's still up and running. Looked at it the other day. It's supposed to, I think, release in September of this year. There's been a lot of good that's come of it. Just the other day, we got a email from Canon. And you know what? I would jump at this stuff normally. They got a new Canon camera coming out. They've picked, 500 people to see. And I was one of the 500. And they wanted to send me this stuff, and I had to fill all this stuff out, and I had to do it by a certain time. And I told my wife, the camera was like an $800 camera, definitely worth it. But I'm like, I don't need another Canon camera. I don't need to do a video for, you know, a minute for them and then keep going back and forth. Great company, phenomenal equipment. But I'm just like, now 6 years into it, 2 years ago, I've been jumping at that and making those videos like I did for other people. But now it's just that it's just not worth it anymore.
Did that come off your TikTok? Is that where that came from?
No, that actually came from YouTube.
Wow, that's incredible.
Yeah, that is incredible. I think what they were looking for was they wanted somebody to represent certain regions. And one of them was the Southwest, and they picked me for Arizona. And I was going to go out, and there was a bunch of stuff in there. You picked the camera. It was one of two cameras. I went online and checked it out, and they have a lot of people doing it on that particular camera. So I knew what it was for. We had one for a computer. My wife was like, we had a problem opening up the software to see what computer you wanted to choose. And they were going to send me another link. I'm like, that's okay. I don't need another computer. So, most people will be like, well, that's just stupid, but it is. But at this point, it's not worth, I don't need another computer. I don't need another Canon camera. If other opportunities came along to do other things like you were talking about, I've only had one of those experiences, and it was a great experience. It was fun to be interviewed by producers. It was fun, to have a possibility of that happening. And there's been a lot of great opportunities that came out of it. Of course, most 99.9% of my opportunities do come off of TikTok, but for the last three endorsements, they've all come off of YouTube.
That's excellent. That's excellent. You know, excellent. YouTube is a difficult, one thing I would tell anybody as well is that stick to whatever you, if you're a explorer, whatever you do, stick to whatever you want to do. Pick a good subject and then stick to it. Because when you flip flop like I have, and you go back and forth, and I'm the king of it, you know, that it doesn't know what to do with your channel. It doesn't know where to take it. It doesn't know where to put you. And when you do that, now shorts have changed that a little bit. Shorts has opened up a whole nother thing too, but I've flip-flopped around so many different times with my channel and changing the name. And I really believe that I did everything that you could do to destroy your channel. I think single-handedly, I've done everything I can do. But, you know, even with the shorts right now, if you're into that side of the business, I do want to pull this up, your channel, so people can see it. Look at a couple videos, you know, just some shorts. If you don't mind, I'd like to open it up and show people. If you're not subscribed to Dean, you can get him on every platform, Arizona Timeless Tourist. And I want to open this up and share the screen and get on here and get in here and look at, let's go here first. So here is his channel. Right here. Now, we all did these more long videos at one time, and then everything seemed to go into the shorts. Shorts became, you know, one of the most popular things. And I'm trying to think where I saw where I'll go in here. Let's go ahead and look at shorts. And let's take a look at because we've got you. Where's, let's look at this one now, because this will show you how crazy. I want to show you this one, Dean, only because I want people to look at how different these platforms are. So let's pull this one up real quick.
This is the gravesite of the most lethal sniper in U.S. military history. This is the gravesite of the most lethal.
So we'll get out of there. We'll come back here at 118 views. Now we'll go back in. And let me see. I don't even know if TikTok will show the views, but we'll go in there. I know I had it in here. Let's go on here. Let's share that. Now, there is the same video right here. At 1.9 million views.
Right here where I'm pointing, that is the grave.
Let me get back in there. Let me get back in there. Sorry about that. I jacked that up. But isn't that like incredible? Okay. That is, there it is. Yeah.
And right next to it.
That or not. Yeah, now we can get back in.
This is the same video of the most 1.7
million
US military history
views. Right there.
Yeah. And the thing is, those are great ones to show, Jeff, because that's got 47,000 likes. I don't know how many thousands of and it was released around the same time. And I did that 2 years ago when I was in Texas. I did another one on that. And that one's at 8.8 million on that same video, but it'll never reach over 1,000 on YouTube.
I mean, that's incredible. It really is. Now, how many people do you have subscribed on TikTok? 180?
184,000.
And then 13 something on YouTube.
Yeah, on YouTube.
That's incredible. I mean, it's incredible. And again, you have the same content. You're putting in different locations. One hits huge. And then the other, for some reason.
Yeah.
Because they're not putting it out. I mean, it's that simple.
If we went over, like, we've had this discussion. I'm on every platform there is. I'm on new platforms that are out there just testing the waters on a new platform. And I'll just tell you what, on this one new platform, I haven't been out there for more than a little over 2 months. I put 65 videos out there just to throw videos out there. And view wise, they've gotten anywhere from 150,000 to 117. And I just got an email yesterday stating that they have picked me for the 4th of July special for their platform for the South, for the whole Southwest. And they want to give me 15 to 20 minutes. They're giving each creator, they're going through five regions, and they're giving me 15 to 20 minutes to do trivia and to tell the history of the state on there. And they've picked seven people for this platform to do it. So it is good, because I told my wife, I'm like, we got about 65 videos on there. I think we're at like 11,000 followers in 2 months, which isn't bad, but it was just a testing water site. And I signed up and had to fill out a lot of paperwork for them today. So I get their whole platform for 15 to 20 minutes with eight other creators in the United States, just to tell them about the state of Arizona, because they picked my channel out of all of them. So it goes to show you that there's not a lot of Arizona content out there. And I'll say this, it's supposed to be the biggest form of flattery, right? When somebody takes your stuff, or a musician uses your music or your video or something like that. It doesn't really feel that way. And I know that myself and Jeff, I met Jeff probably almost 3 years ago, first YouTube guy I ever met. So we sat for some coffee. And when I was out there doing this stuff, Google was my only place. I would Google hidden gems in Arizona, because I didn't want to go to these Grand Canyons, Sedonas, Flagstaffs. I wanted to go some hidden spots, not where everybody else went. And I would be on there. My wife can attest to this, 3 to 4 hours a day. And Google kind of catches on to what you're doing. And every now and then it pops up new stuff. And I knew how hard it was to find, let's just take Monument Hill there, where all the land was marked out at. Okay, if you take Monument Hill, there was one video that popped up after I did mine that was like 9 years old. And now you can go out there and you can find numerous videos on this place and all these other like with you and your petroglyphs. We know the gentleman, I did not know you gave a location to, that made a video on that. But it's all the time and effort and energy to, people think these places are automatically known just because mine is history and it can be found in some cities or just out in the outskirts. Anybody could find it. But I'll tell you this, in 2017, I would say 95% of the videos that I posted out there were not out there. They weren't out there to be found. And all that came off of Google search engines 3 hours a day for like 2 years straight.
Well, and that's kind of the interesting thing, that when we were going out, you know, I would look for a place that didn't, and there was no videos. You know, a lot of places that really helped me was these hiking sites that would, they would say this, well, they saw them there, right? But there was no pictures or there was no nothing. And to me, that was a cool deal. To a lot of people, that was very threatening. And that was a lot of, you know, there's a lot of fear. I was told that by individuals within the organization, there was a lot of fear. And it was like, you know, I'm not trying to do things to, you know, I'm looking to go out and have an adventure. And so like with your videos, for example, like what's a video here that you've done in the last year that's really excited you?
Yeah. The only video in the last 2 years, or the story that's excited me after now we're 6.5 years in, is the Tewksbury Graham feud. So that's the thing that we always have, myself and Jeff always have this conversation about doing what you want to do, because I put in a lot of time in the Tewksbury Graham feud, and I went up the road and shot a cabin and got, I don't know, somewhere around 500,000 views on this cabin. And one time I was up there, got 29,000 people on a live talking about this. So then I decided 2 years later to go to the town, the place, Young, Arizona, in the middle of no man's land. Going to take 3 hours, 15 minutes to get there. Dirt road, cruddy. If you've ever been on the 288, you know. And spend 7 hours out of my day on travel and get there and film this and come back. And you're looking at 400 or 500 views at the most. So, but I have the whole story. The story is phenomenal. I really believe I've pushed that story out there in the last 2 years, where there wasn't videos before. And if there was, there was a documentary that you can't get anymore. You can't see it anymore. It's private. There wasn't a lot of people doing stuff. So what made me happy was now I see a lot of stuff on the Tewksbury Graham feud. I just went on Ancient Explorers or something on Facebook the other day, and some guy was talking about it. And I'm like, so I put a little bit out there, and it shot up, and everybody was loving it. But that story, I could probably work on that in another 2 or 3 years and go on touring events if somebody would hire me and talk about the Tewksbury Graham feud. Like, get Jeff on the side of the Hatfield and McCoys, and Dean on the side of the Tewksbury Grahams that hasn't been told. And that would be a great night of talking about these unbelievable feuds.
I'm gonna pull your site back up and watch a couple videos, if you don't mind. That's Chris Kyle. We'll go there. I should pull it up, and I just have to find it once we get out of there.
All right, I'm up at the Lulabs. The oldest,
try to figure out how to get over
on a tombstone home in the state of Arizona.
Okay, let's get back to shorts.
We're going YouTube or TikTok?
That's TikTok, or this is YouTube here.
Oh,
they want to do and get out of there.
I remember when I was filming that cat raccoon out there, girl.
That's a wild one right there. So let's get, I'll put you back. We'll get back on, open that up right here. And look at There TikTok. Is.
If you go like to the last one over there, the one that's got 3,000 right there, that's the one that I shot in Yum.
It says that some historians dispute about how the feud started.
I finally made it to Yum, Arizona. Look, the bloodiest feud in U.S. history happened right here, right down there in that valley. This was not a feud about sheep. You might have heard that.
The Graham-Tewksbury feud, 1882 to
1892. Yeah, I should have aired down the tires because I'm sliding all over the place.
The bloodiest part of this feud started happening in the latter part of 1887. That included brand changing, cattle and horse rustling, ambushes, murder.
Right off the side because there's no barrier.
All right, we can go to the next one.
Let me show you some of these views. But it's watch me on TikTok, YouTube, Instagram, Facebook. I'm looking for a sponsor. If anyone wants to sponsor the Arizona Timeless Tours, please contact me at the AZTT at the AZTT.org.
It says that some
and you've had really good luck with like cabins, right? This is the cabin. But let's go ahead. It's actually this one. Let's pull this.
No. Mary Ann Tewksbury Rhodes survived the Pleasant Valley War from 1882 to 1892. Her husband was killed when she was 8 months pregnant. Apaches raided the Tewksbury cabin in 1882. 82 horses were taken by the Apaches and 16 were left for dead. Mary Ann and John helped hold off the Apaches so they wouldn't burn the cabin down. On January 12, 1883, Mary Ann witnessed the first shots fired in the Pleasant Valley War. She was a witness to an event that would be discussed for more than a century.
The thing with the cabin too is I've shot probably 15 videos out there and they range anywhere from 500,000 to like 5,000 views. So it truly, if I was telling anybody, it really does matter. It doesn't matter anymore. There are videos that I've reposted, like that's a repost. I think it only got like 6,000 views, but the first post got like 75,000 views. It does matter. Especially on TikTok and these other platforms, what time you post these things. And unfortunately, I'm in this mode of I just want to keep this stuff fresh and updated, because when you got more than 1,100 TikToks out there like I do, people are not going to your catalog. So that's something I would tell somebody right off the bat. Look, if you get a video that hit 150,000 in 72 hours, in the next 72 hours, you need to repost that video again. And then in another 4 or 5 days, you need to repost that video again until it goes down to you only get like 2 or 3,000. Because what people are going to do, especially in that Tewksbury Graham feud stuff, is they ask for more. It's all in the comment section. Can you show it? I'm like, man, I did one of those 15 videos ago, 25 videos, but they're so spread apart. When you got a catalog of 1,100 plus videos in the last 2 years, people are not going to your channel. You can look at your own analytics and see it. What the percentage of people that go to your homepage, they're going, they're seeing it. So every now and then, I think the average person goes to the last 2 to 3 TikToks and then they move on. Mine are way out there. So you could be looking at that and the next video could be the Corona spy satellite targets. The next one after that could be the Francisco Grande with the San Francisco Giants. They're not back to where they thought they were going to get. So they move away from your channel. So if you're out there and you get one of those 100,000 plus videos, which isn't that difficult to do on TikTok, you want to keep hitting that thing until it dies. And people will be like, well, you're putting the same content out there, and you're not. Because believe me, I've put, 1,100 videos, probably 79 of them are redos. There's never been one person on TikTok that has come along and said, I've seen that. Because there's so many videos that they never get back to that. You could repost, I think, the same video every 2 weeks, and somebody, they'll never see the same one twice.
That, you know, that is, there's so much to this stuff when you're doing this. There's so much out there. There's so much, man, there's so many hurdles and so much, you know, that you throw at this. And you know, you never want to tell anybody, don't do it. I mean, you know, you want them, whatever they live on, you know, I mean, if you want to experience it, you should get to experience it. But man, it is a tough road. It's a tough road to be successful on any media platform. If you look at success being monetary, if you look at success being numbers, views, but usually they go hand in hand. That's the only problem.
Well, let's be truthful. I'm sitting on about 2.89 million views for last month on TikTok. 2.89 million. And people are like, "Woo, you're going to get paid." If you got 2.89 million on YouTube, yeah, you're going to get paid. If you got 2.89 million on TikTok, you might have $150 coming your way. So it's not, none of this stuff pays off. And I think if I was to give anybody any advice, I'd be like, go out there, have a fun time, be creative, and do your thing. You said it earlier, don't get anything but your phone, because your phone can shoot 4 and 8K, and it's just as good as any Canon camera. The only thing different than the DSLR is you can get more light in. Who cares? But just know this, that I know these people that get paid $1,500 a month, and their average on their YouTube videos is 68,000 views per week. They put one out every week. That's 68,000. They're doing this stuff constantly, uploading videos for $1,500 a week. I'm telling you, almost 3 million views isn't getting you anywhere on TikTok. And that, I mean, so you got to look at the long run. You got to be like, well, what are you in it for? Are you in it just to be creative? Then go for it. If you're in it that you think you're going to make it, make it money-wise, I'm giving you numbers that majority of the people are never going to come close to. And you're looking at $1,500 on one platform and maybe $200 on the other platform. You're going to get more exposure on TikTok than YouTube. I don't know how many hundreds of millions and millions of views I have on there and how many product endorsements I've gotten and opportunities I've gotten. But getting paid Jeff said it earlier, we were on the thing called Newsbreak. I was making more money on Newsbreak than I've ever made altogether on every platform, period, in a 12-month period. So that will go to show you. And Newsbreak is just a small thing that most people have never even heard of. And so if you're out there thinking that monetarily this is going to work for you, I mean, I would just be the realist and say, I've already thrown these numbers out. Are you 60,000 on, are you averaging 30 to 60,000 views on YouTube? Because if you're not, then that money's not coming your way. And if you, I would say probably maybe about 5 to 8 million on TikTok, if you're not averaging that, then that's not coming your way either.
Yeah, it's a tough gig when, especially if you think that, and again, yeah, do it for the love, do it for the love. If you, you know, and again, hey, you know what? Put out what you want to do. Do what you want to do, and keep your expectations low. And then, hey, if it goes better, you know, great. If it doesn't, you know,
well, yeah,
you've got some good stuff to look at. You know, one thing I've always told Dean is, when we die, our families have a lot of stuff to look at.
Oh boy, yeah, our faces are not going away. The one great thing I can say though is when I'm counseling somebody, and I would say it's a counseling session on social media, is that I can be in a position of saying, I can go from 100 views on something to 8.8 million views on something. And then the next month go from 1.9 million to 200 views because I've hit all of those markers. And that's where I'm like, I have a little oomph behind what I'm saying here on what you're going to make. Because if I was a guy sitting there that got what I normally would get, 200 to 300, maybe 400 views per thing, I would be like, I would be shooting for the star. I'd be like, at one point, I'm going to break out. At one point, I'm going to break out. And that happened a year and a half ago overnight at 1.6 million views. And at the end of the week, over 3 million. And after the end of the year, 8.8 million. And I'm just saying that monetarily, it's not anything. It really isn't anything. It feels good to have those kind of numbers. You can show off. You can boost your ego a little bit by saying, well, I mean, I've had videos ranging from 1 million to almost 9 million. You know, you can say those kinds of things, but where they're actually getting you, what is actually doing for you, whether you want to do it for your life, you want to be on the road, you want something to help pay for it. That little place called Newsbreak did more for me in 12 months than all of those views put together on TikTok, YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, all those spots. One news media outlet gave me more money than all of those that I've been doing for 6.5 years.
And it did exactly what they do, just like YouTube did. They built their platform on the backs of their creators. And then when they built it, then they cut their legs off and they took it down to nothing.
Well, you saw it on YouTube. You were, you know, like you said, the Lost Dutchman was big. You were making money thinking, hey, man, this could be, you know, a second income, pay things off like I was doing. And all of a sudden, boom, it's gone. One day, it's just gone.
I had a Lost Dutchman videos. And we, like I said, I was the number one Google for Lost Dutchman. If you looked at Lost Dutchman, you saw me. I was there. I was all over it, right? And there was a month that I had a video hit really hard and I made $500. I mean, out of the blue, $500. And I thought, this is the greatest thing ever. I'm going to go full blast. And this was years ago too. This was back in, man, at least 8-9 years ago. I mean, this was a long time ago. And man, I was like, I can do something with this. And no sooner did that happen, they shut the monetization down completely. Shut it down completely, changed their whole thought process. And I didn't post videos for 3 or 4 years after that. And, you know, isn't that crazy? That's a dumb on my part too.
And look, both me and you, look, we had an extraordinary ride on YouTube. I don't know if this is like 8 months to a year ago now, because it seemed like it was just a speck of sand on all the seashores of the world, just thrown up in the air somehow, some way. The small air, and this is the thing. This is why I'm getting those people coming to me on YouTube right now, because I can guarantee they looked at the algorithm or something and said that this guy jumped from this to this within a year, because it took 5 years to hit 5,000 followers on YouTube. 5 years, man. I grueled it out on editing. I mean, you're talking 3 to 4 hours an edit, maybe between 40 and 80 short clips that I'm downloading and trying to put together. And it just taking me a day or two and finding the music and having all this copyright stuff and going through all of this stuff. I'm trying to think here. Because the music that I pay for the music now, but did you use the free YouTube music?
Not really.
Your stuff?
No.
Yeah. I'm trying to think. I'll just go off with that, but it's just ridiculous how much time and effort and stuff. And we had that speck of time that one video, I think my best video ever was 22,000. It was on the town of Gilbert, because the town of Gilbert took it and put it on their website and still has it on there today. But overnight, it was the feud. 575,000 views. The next video hit 450,000 views. The next one up, 375,000 views. Went from 5,000 views that I grinded out, just grinded out for 5 years. In what, Jeff? It couldn't have been more than 30 days to over 13,000 followers and going from under a million total views to just under 3 million total views in about 28 days.
Well, and it's, you know, they open those doors. Sometimes they open those doors. And when they do, you know, we all know on the shorts that, you know, you never know. It could hit, you could get 7 views and, excuse me real quick. Excuse me. You get 7 views, you get downloaded again, you hit 15 or you get 22,000 and there's no thumbnail. There's no nothing. The only thing you have is a title and they just throw it out there. They don't throw it out there. And, yeah. You know, sometimes it's timing. Sometimes it could be the title a little bit, but you're not using keywords. It's none of that stuff. They open the door, they shut the door and they open the door for me.
I spent money on TubeBuddy trying to get all of the hashtags and everything. Those videos, we talked about this, all those videos came off of a title and hashtag shorts. And I didn't care what time of day I was putting it out there. That's what'll get you and grab you when you've been doing this long enough. You know you have videos that are good enough to get out there and be seen. In 5 years, you've been doing this and putting a lot of work, effort, and money into this, okay? And then in 1 month, they open the doors to a video that you have placed out there before that may have gotten 300 views. And I tell you what, and Jeff knows this, I probably worked for 250 of those views by sharing it on every Facebook site I can possibly get so I could get some views. And then in less than a month, they give me 2 million total views and 3 videos that just absolutely explode to over 500,000 views on one and close to another one. And you can't say that the stuff that you put out there before wasn't worthy of that. So you kind of see they've got you locked in. We got these conspiracy things, Jeff and I, on why our stuff doesn't get out there. And sometimes I'm thinking it's just my content sucks. You know, it's just not good enough content. How come in that 30 days, the content, 3 of those videos were good enough to explode my channel to over 2 million views and then completely be shut off after that 30 days? That's the stuff you got to ride on these platforms. And that's why I'm probably the last person to give somebody advice on it, because if you really want realistic advice, if you are not doing it for the fun and the love, then you're just wasting your time.
Well, look at that. The one we showed to started the short at 113 versus 1.8 million. Yeah. So why does one platform tell you that it's the greatest video ever at 1.8 million? That definitely is. And then the other platform that's parallel to it, that's competing against each other, has said that, no, that's a horrible video, I guess. Right. I mean, wow, it's when you put it. And one platform says that's the greatest video ever. And so, you know, there's no balance between it. And so, you know, is it a good video? Yeah. I mean, I can tell you a million different reasons why I think that it's a successful video, but you know, YouTube just shut it down, whatever reason or why, you just don't know. And that's not the quality of your video. That's what's sad. It's not that it was a great video or a poor video. It had nothing to do. It was a good video and it hit. And it was a good video on one station and it didn't hit. And you know, and same video, same everything, same music, same whole. And that's where it gets frustrating, is that, is it just the door, I look at these guys, it seems like they opened the door for it, because here's the truth. If YouTube wanted to make you famous and rich today, they could, in the morning, you could wake up and you would be famous and you would be rich. They could do it. They can do that. They can open that door. Just like they can shut it. And it's pretty incredible that's out of your, that's out of your hands of what they decide and what they don't. You know, all you can do is put the best video out you can, and that's it. And
that's why I have great comebacks to other YouTubers that are like, well, you're just not trying. No. Because again, it's not an ego thing. It's just that I have the ammo now to say, well, let me show you what my total views are on all these platforms. Let me show you what my greatest videos are. And you can't say that I wasn't putting it out on a regular basis on YouTube for the first 5 years. Every other day, there was a video being uploaded. You can't, it goes to show you that the harder you can try your hardest. Just like I believe on YouTube, if you weren't there in 2007, 2008, you're not going to be one of these big boys. The guys that are out there that I can list all the names that tell you how to get your first 1,000 subscribers in the first 48 hours and stuff. All these guys were out there. If you look at the beginning of their YouTube time, were in 2007, 2008, 2009. Didn't mean that they had to be good. They were the first ones on the platform. TikTok is about almost 3.5 years old. I got it on it on the second year. I was one of the lucky ones before they slowed everything down. You can put as much great content as you want out there. Most people cannot hit 200,000 followers on TikTok anymore. It's not attainable to most people anymore.
If you hit 32 and then it went backwards. It went backwards.
If you were in there at the beginning, you had it. So you have to be in at the beginning of these sites to get, you know, to be there. I was a year and a half late, but you know, when you let's just take this. When you hit the 1.2 million overnight, that was 10,000 followers overnight I gained. Okay. I fast forward it 2 years on TikTok. You got within a month, I got 1.9 million views on a video. I attained a huge 520 new followers off of 1.9 million. 1.4 gave me 10,000. Now it doesn't even pull 600. They're not giving you the followers anymore.
Yeah, it's definitely a different one. Well, man, I appreciate our talk tonight. We'll get back into more of it.
Yeah. I'm looking forward to listening to other people because I truly am. I'm hoping that other people come on, and it's just the fact of hearing where they want to go with what they're doing. The guy that you got in contact with, you mentioned his name earlier. He's driving all over. A lot of gas going in there, a lot of camera, a lot of time. And I'm just wondering what's the purpose here? What is the end all? Are you have a lot of money and you just want a way to take up your time, or you're out there trying to produce something that will bring an income in that you'll have a side job or something like that, and you'll get an extra $1,000 to $1,500 a month. I'm looking forward to it because I love to hear from all these people after the time we've done, and really I've only got 6.5 years in. You got a lot more than that in, and to seeing where we're at, great opportunities came our way. I've got a lot of products sitting in the closet next to me of people that have sent me stuff, but I'm looking forward to hearing those answers.
Excellent. Hopefully they'll come on. Hopefully they won't be afraid of live. And and we'll figure that out if they are. Dean, it's been a pleasure always, man. I appreciate you, and I will see you, sir. We're going to try to get on a bunch of different people. I want to talk to a lot of people about, you know, the shooting Arizona, the Southwest, doing things like that, and then their experience in social media and what their goals are, and I hope we can get more on. And because I'm fascinated by it, just like Dean is. I mean, you know, it's definitely trying. It definitely is. It can be frustrating, but we keep doing it. Whether that's an addiction of some type, who knows? You know, and you're looking for growth, and sometimes you get it, and sometimes you don't. And so we'll see where that goes. You'll see me putting another podcast out about the vehicles that we're going to take on the trail. I'm going to start getting heavily involved in that side of it as well, whether it be e-bikes or motorcycles or ATVs or UTVs, whatever it might be. You're going to see that coming on because I want to kind of get back to my roots. The bike business has always been my roots, and then going to explore on those vehicles is where we're heading. So I want to thank Mr. Don Barry and Mr. Steve Lyons for helping us get another show on the road. And I appreciate you guys. Thanks again for that. And Todd Beck, happy birthday. I saw that it was your birthday today, and he's been in and out with us for a long time, and I appreciate him and what he does. And man, we're going to get out of here tonight. I'm going to be on the road, not next week, but the week after. So it should be interesting what we bring back, considering we have no idea where we're going. We're going to point the car and we're going to go.
What side am I on? What side am I supposed to be on? I never know.
Adios, amigos. Looks like we'll have Small Town Tourist as soon as he gets back from vacation. It'll be awesome. And I appreciate each and every one of you. Again, thanks for hanging out, and I'll see you soon. Adios.